Welcome to All Things Financial with Jack Driscoll.
Welcome back again, everyone, to another edition of All Things Financial. We've been doing a series on business succession planning. I have a special guest with us today and the last couple shows, Dan Zugel. Dan, thanks for coming on the show.
Oh, thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Dan's a Senior Vice President of Business Transition Advisors. And Dan, we've done a couple shows. I'd like you to maybe recap to catch anybody up who had not caught those other shows what it is we're talking about here today.
Oh, of course. We're talking today, as we were the last few weeks, about ESOPs, Employee Stock Ownership Plans. ESOPs are a form of business succession and exit strategy for a business owner. It happens to be a qualified retirement plan, just like a 401k, pension plan, profit sharing plan, covered under the same code sections as those type plans, but it has one investment, Jack, and that's the stock of the sponsoring company in which the selling shareholder sells his shares to. The government really likes ESOPs. I know I've talked about this a couple times, and I'll just briefly summarize. The government likes ESOPs because ESOPs get shares of the company in which they help build into the hands of the employees. They get to share the value of the business that they help build. And the government likes that because, in theory, that's less strain on the government safety net later on. And I often get asked, what's a typical candidate? Who considers an ESOP? What do they look like? Well, first of all, from a statistical standpoint, it's generally a business worth about $5 million of value because there's costs associated with installing an ESOP and maintaining an ESOP. So a business with about $1 million of earnings equates to about a $5 million business, I would say, about 20 or more employees and about $1 million of payroll. That's where the tax advantages generally start working for an ESOP. But the more real life ESOP candidate, like, what do they look like? Well, I often use, and I've done throughout, Joe's Cement Company. Joe started a cement business with a wheelbarrow and a bag of Quikrete 20, 30, 40 years ago. Has grown a business, bought trucks, paid off trucks, bought buildings, bought competitors, and grown this business, maybe put some money in some retirement plan, little savings here and there, maybe a fishing cabin somewhere, but almost plowed all their money back into this business. Maybe put a kid through college or two, but now's the time. Joe and Mary are 55, 60, 65 years old thinking, what am I gonna do with this business? And I think it's great that Joe and Mary are considering doing something with their business, because we've had a conversation in the past about many business owners who do nothing and then suffer the consequences of what happens to their business after death of the creator and the founder of this company, and it doesn't bode well for the family. So pre-planning in any method makes sense. And we've talked about the different methods of selling an ESOP briefly, just highlight management buyouts. We have corporate redemption, where the company just uses the after-tax dollars they generate and buy the shares from the selling shareholder, and outright sales. You know, maybe you have a strategic buyer. Maybe you have a private equity buyer, which is a financial buyer, somebody that coming in and just offering a fair market value for the business and just wants to be there and run the business or acquire it and roll it up under the main company. But ESOP's the fourth kind of leg on that stool that, frankly, we don't hear as much about. And it is a more and more popular way of transferring a business. As we've talked about in the past, some of the federal legislation that's pending to increase ESOP ownership by employees and to increase employee wealth, as well as some Pennsylvania state legislation to increase employee ownership. So it is growing in popularity, although they've been around for 44 years. And so we're focusing the last couple programs on the ESOP aspect of it because it's least talked about. And an ESOP does have many advantages for the selling shareholder, the company, the community, and the employees. First of all, the selling shareholder finds a ready and willing buyer. The ESOP has mainly one investment, and that's the stock of the selling shareholder, stock of the sponsoring company, which is owned by the selling shareholder. So the ready and willing buyer at full fair market value is ready and waiting, and that being the ESOP. And as I mentioned, it is full fair market value, and potentially the proceeds, the sale price that's normally taxable as a capital gains tax, Because in my example, Joe started this business with practically nothing, a wheelbarrow and a bag of Quikrete, and has grown it to a $20, $30 million business, there's a large taxable gain on the proceeds. However, based on one of the oldest ESOP provisions, if an owner sells their stock to an ESOP, which the government encourages, the owner can potentially defer and eliminate the capital gains taxes that are normally due. Additionally, the business owner can stay involved in the business as long as they want to stay involved. A manager, they could be president and CEO, still be chair of the board, get salary, perks, benefits, health care, cars, clubs, the things that it's normally appropriate for a president and CEO of a company. And they get to retain their family legacy in the community, which is very important.
So you're saying an owner could do this long before they expected to retire?
Absolutely. In fact, it works best if the owner does stick around.
Okay.
Because often there's financing involved, and the seller wants to make sure that the financing paid off both to the bank, and if there's any seller financing, they want to make sure they get paid.
Okay.
So this, where an ESOP does not work is if the owner generally wants out immediately. They want out tomorrow. I want to sell it, get a check, and move on. Well, an ESOP's probably not the best pick. I would encourage them to look at an outright buyer of some sort.
Okay.
in that scenario. So they generally do want to stick around for a while. So many advantages to the seller, as you can tell. Now, to the employees, it's a tremendous advantage to the employees. Well, first of all, they're getting a beneficial interest in the company in which they work. They have, when they retire, die, become disabled, or even quit or get fired, they have a right to turn in their stock to the company, and the company must buy back the shares from them when they leave. That's a tremendous benefit. In fact, employees of ESOP companies earn, well, their retirement benefit, total benefit, is about 2.5 times those of employees in comparable companies that do not have an ESOP. Additionally, employees of ESOP-owned companies during the recent recession were 4 times less likely to be laid off than companies that do not have ESOPs.
Wow.
And ESOP companies grow their employee base 25% higher than non-ESOP companies.
Yeah, because that's a huge benefit.
Absolutely, it sure is. And so the employees really benefit. Now the company benefits because one of the tax advantages we're going to pick up on when we get to where we left off last time, one of the advantages, the company profits of the company are no longer subject to federal or state income tax. So the tax literally goes away.
Can you say that again, Dan?
I will say that one more time. I might not have said it clearly. To the extent a company is ESOP owned, and a lot of companies are tending to go 100% ESOP owned, to the extent, if structured properly, the profits of that company are no longer subject to federal or state income tax. Nobody pays tax. The selling shareholder doesn't pay tax, the company doesn't pay tax, and the ESOP doesn't pay tax because it's a qualified retirement plan, just like a 401k, who also does not pay income tax.
Okay.
And so the ESOP, nobody pays tax, and that is very good for the company when we're talking about the company advantages.
Yes.
And that's why one political part of the end of the political spectrum really likes ESOP. They figure, what's going to grow American businesses more than a company not paying income tax? Who's going to hire people? Who's going to buy buildings? Who's going to expand product base and reach and territories and things of that sort? And those are companies that are not paying tax. So it's tremendous for the company itself. Now for the community, and this is little talked about. We touched on it previously,
right?
But the community really benefits from an ESOP. When a outside buyer sometimes comes in, a competitor, a strategic buyer, a private equity firm, come into a company and buy a company from a small town, there's a very, very strong possibility that the key management of that company are probably let go because the acquirer has a CFO, the acquirer has a president. There's a good chance that a lot of folks are let go. There's also a good chance that they might just want a patent and they may consolidate manufacturing facilities, and especially in some of the small towns, this employer might be one of the largest in town. When somebody comes in and shuts that certain division down, there might be a lot of jobs lost. And additional to, certain folks come in are lean and mean, there's a good chance the library's not getting that donation, there's a good chance that the Little League's not getting their shirts made anymore,
right,
and a good chance that a lot of the community involvement kind of goes away. Plus a lot of those employees that have gotten 4% raises for the last 40 years, there's a good chance they're no longer there and they're replaced with somebody else. So
sometimes
from the community
they move
fabric,
the whole company.
Sometimes they move the whole company
and
say, you can still have a job, but you got to move across the country.
Right.
And that's unfortunate. And ESOP solves that. So the community legacy and the contribution to the fabric of that community can remain intact. Mm-hmm. And the seller's name that's on the door can still walk around in that town proudly knowing they did right by their employees. So it works well for a lot of folks. We then talked about earlier that how an ESOP works. And the ESOP is created by the company. The bank lends money to the ESOP. The company uses that money to buy stock from the selling shareholder. The company then makes contributions to the ESOP, and the ESOP uses that money to pay off the bank loans.
Mm-hmm.
And then the employees are given shares, literally allocated, given shares through no out-of-pocket cost of their own over a period of 20 to 40 years.
Okay.
And that's to establish a long-term employee benefit plan that keeps employees there, keeps them working hard, and increases their retirement benefits. And then when those employees leave, as we mentioned, then the employees can cash out. When they retire, die, become disabled, they quit or get fired, and something called diversification, they have a right to turn in their stock and then get cash for their stock. And a company has an obligation to buy the stock back. Then the employees roll that money into IRAs, into individual IRAs, because it is qualified plan money. They can defer the tax even longer on that.
Okay.
And then we also talked about some of the tax advantages. One is the seller, we talked about this, the seller can indefinitely defer the capital gains. We've talked about that. If they invest the money properly, they do it within a certain time period, and there are certain products that are designed to facilitate this and make it very tax efficient. The company gets a dollar-for-dollar income tax deduction for every dollar sold to the ESOP. So a $10 million company gets sold, the company gets a corporate deduction of $10 million, which ironically becomes irrelevant if the next tax advantage is taken advantage of. We talked about if a company is 100% owned by an ESOP and becomes an S corporation ESOP, then the profits are no longer taxable. That makes the $10 million deduction we just talked about absolutely irrelevant.
Wow.
For as great of an advantage that is, it becomes irrelevant. Then there's some estate tax benefits that are available to an ESOP company. And this is exactly where we left off.
Mm-hmm.
We were talking about the company being tax-free. And some people often say to me, well, how exactly does that work? Like, why? How does that happen? Well, here's how that happens. Because the company is a pass-through entity, and an ESOP must be a C corporation or S corporation. So, but entities like LLCs, partnerships, S corporations, they are typically flow-through entities, which means the profits of the company are taxable, and it flows through the tax burden flows through to the owner of that S corporation or LLC. In our scenario that we're talking about today, the ESOP is the owner of the stock. As the owner of the stock being an ESOP, a qualified defined contribution retirement plan, it's not subject to federal state income tax. Therefore, the company does not need to declare distributions.
I see.
I know we're getting into the weeds a little bit here, but that's how business owners of pass-through entities pay their tax. They have a tax burden proportionate to their ownership. They file it on their own 1040, but then what they do is they take distributions. They take money out of the company generally equal to the amount of tax they owe.
Mm-hmm.
They take the money out of the business and then personally write that check to the federal and state government to pay the taxes they owe. So the company loses that tax money because it has to leave the company to go to the selling shareholder so they can pay their income tax. When the ESOP owns the stock, no taxes due, therefore no money has to leave the company anymore to pay tax because nobody owes tax.
Okay.
And that money that stays at the corporate level is now used to pay off, and it's usually more than enough, to pay off the debt that's incurred to buy the stock in the first place.
Wow.
And usually the company's in a better cash flow position by selling 100% of the stock than they are by selling only half the stock.
Really?
And we just have to do the math. And that's where we left off. So we kind of picked up, talked about, finished off the tax benefits of the S corporation. And the fourth tax advantage is the estate planning advantages.
Perfect.
Now, we're going to talk about that later in maybe in another segment about how we finance an ESOP.
Okay.
But in the financing package, there are some estate planning techniques, opportunities that can transfer massive amounts of current generation wealth into the hands of future generations with literally zero or little estate and gift tax consequence.
Okay.
So we'll address that at a different time. So I often get asked now, say, okay, now that I understand all the tax benefits and I understand how it works and why the government likes it, but man, I really want to know about who controls an ESOP company?
Okay.
Who determines what value I get out of it? And who votes the ESOP shares? And Jack, those are good questions.
Yeah,
that's... we get asked that a lot. So I thought we'd address them.
Yeah, and I'm sure the employees are concerned about that too.
They totally are. They totally are. So for the who owns the shares technically? Yes, the ESOP does own the shares, but the ESOP's a qualified plan trust. There needs to be an individual who represents that ESOP trust. And that individual is called a trustee. So every ESOP has a trustee, and there's different types of trustees. For the transaction, when we're determining the sale and how much the stock's gonna be worth, and we're determining the fair terms of the deal between the ESOP trust and the seller, because it is an arm's length transaction. Mm-hmm. It's a sale. The seller is selling shares, and they have to agree upon a price with the ESOP trust that is represented by a trustee. So for the actual transaction itself, generally an independent trustee, somebody unrelated to the company, is brought in to represent the ESOP and in effect representing the interest of the employees to make sure they didn't pay too much money for the shares of stock.
Wow.
Even though they're being given and allocated shares through no out-of-pocket cost, the Department of Labor still wants to make sure that they're getting the proper value.
Okay.
And they're not overpaying for the stock that's in the ESOP trust. And so, therefore, an independent trustee is advised on almost every ESOP transaction. And that ESOP trustee has several responsibilities. A, as I mentioned, make sure that the ESOP doesn't overpay for the stock.
Mm-hmm.
And then also represent to the Department of Labor, hey, I'm independent. I don't know this company. I'm representing the employees, and I can represent and sign off on the fact that they paid a fair price,
okay,
and the employer, you know, didn't have their brother-in-law do the valuation,
right,
and that the terms of the agreement and the management incentive packages that might be out there, all part of the negotiated deal, mm-hmm, are all reasonable, and that the trustee can sign off on those that deal and say, hey, I'm okay with that. And so the ESOP trustee is voting and taking care of the transaction. Now, that's during the transaction. Sometime after the ESOP transaction, well, we're just back to running the company, and we're going to talk about control. The ESOP trustee is now maybe not that same independent trustee we were talking about before. Mm. Sometimes after the transaction, the company appoints an internal trustee, maybe the CFO, the HR director, somebody that understands at least the basics of qualified plans.
Okay.
Now, this internal trustee may or may not be directed, a directed trustee, whereas the independent trustee, as the name suggests, is independent to negotiate the terms of the deal and come to a negotiate a price with the seller. An internal trustee who subsequently votes the stock is generally directed by the board of directors.
Okay.
So the board of directors directs the trustee how to vote the shares of stock in the everyday running of the business. That's not relegated to management or officers. The board decisions that are normally made are still made at the board level. The board simply informs the directed trustee to show up at the board meeting and vote the way the board instructs that directed trustee to vote, unless the board instructs that trustee to do something that's clearly negative to the employees or illegal,
okay,
which unfortunately we've seen.
Wow.
So the trustee has to be smart enough and understand enough that this is not in the best interest of the employees and it doesn't smell right, and therefore I either resign or I vote against it, but otherwise they can only vote as directed by the board of trustees.
Okay.
So that's who votes the shares of stock, and that's even if the ESOP owns 100%. So now the question comes, well then who controls the board? If the board controls the directed trustee, then who controls the board? Mm. Is that the trustee? Is that my employees? Are they all voting? And the answer is the board pre-ESOP is very often the board post-ESOP with a few caveats. So the selling shareholder can still be on the board, still be the chairman, chairperson of the board, as well as the other board members. The caveat is many times in the current ESOP environment, it may be important to have some independent board member.
Okay.
But that doesn't mean they have to be anti Joe Cement Company. It could be a friendly competitor. It could be somebody from church or the club that understands business, that can actually contribute to the business.
Okay.
And the reason we want one or more independent board members in a minority, doesn't have to be a majority. So mom and pop and kid and key managers that are on the board now still have the voting controlling interest.
Mm-hmm.
However, they do need some representation of a minority board member, particularly on issues of compensation. And so the board just continues to run the business, directs the trustee how to vote unless it's illegal, and the board continues to run the board until the board doesn't want to be on the board anymore.
Okay.
And then the board says, I choose not to be on the board anymore. And one more duty, and the employees do not have actual votes. The employees have a beneficial interest in this trust, not voting rights. They're not actual employees. Because you notice in the control side of things, I didn't talk about the employees voting. They do not have a voting interest. They just have a right to the value of the stock that's in the trust being managed and voted for by the trustee on their behalf.
Okay.
And the trustee also is in charge of making sure they get a fair market valuation and representing to the trustee, representing to the Department of Labor that was a fair value and the employees did not overpay. And that trustee, with the help of their valuation firm, negotiates with the shareholder for a sales price, and then the deal is finished.
So a professional valuation has to be done in that process?
Yes, it has to be done up front, and part of the ongoing costs of an ESOP is an annual valuation.
Ah.
So we have to know what the employees are owed should they leave in any given
year. Okay, that's a good point.
So it's done every year. It's one of the ongoing expenses, which is why we require a certain level of size of a company to be able to absorb those fixed costs.
I see. Well, Dan, thank you very much. We're out of time again today, folks. Dan, I appreciate your coming on, and I'd like you to come on one more week, if you don't mind, and we can wrap up some of this subject.
That'd be great. Love to.
Thanks again, everyone, for tuning in and listening to another edition of All Things Financial. We'll be back again next week. Dan, if anybody wants to get a hold of you, what's the best way for them to do that?
Well, the best way to get a hold of me is by phone at 724-766-3998. That's 724-766-3998. Or dzugell, dzugell at bta.us.com. Or visit my website at esopguy.com.
Very good. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you.
You've been listening to All Things Financial with your friend with the answers to all financial matters, Jack Driscoll of Driscoll Insurance and Financial Services. Securities and investment advisory services offered through Sage Point Financial Incorporated, a registered broker-dealer and registered investment advisor and member FINRA and SIPC. Driscoll Insurance and Financial Services is not affiliated with Sage Point Financial, Inc. or registered as a broker-dealer or investment advisor. You can reach Driscoll Insurance and Financial Services Incorporated at 412-833-1500, and they are located at 2738 South Park Road, Bethel Park, Pennsylvania, 15102.